Stand as you are able and face the cross on the center aisle as we begin worship with confession and forgiveness. Blessed be God, the one who forms us, Jesus who bears the cross, the Spirit who makes our joy complete. Amen. Let us come before God in humility, confessing our sin. Steadfast and faithful God, you have revealed the ways of justice, yet we fail to follow you. We are overwhelmed by the world's violence and suffering. We are afraid to risk what we have for the sake of others. For the harm we have caused, known and unknown, forgive us. For the unjust demands we place on others and your creation, forgive us. For the ways we turn away from you and our neighbor, forgive us. Lead us back to you and set us on the right path. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Beloved in Christ, God's justice stretches beyond all understanding. God's compassion is beyond compare. In Jesus, God is always making a new way for us. In Christ, you are already and always forgiven. Amen. We share in singing the first hymn.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Beloved God, from you come all things that are good. Lead us by the inspiration of your Spirit to know those things that are right, and by your merciful guidance, help us to do them. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. I'm Pastor Greg Williams, one of the pastors here at St. John's. It's a joy to have all of you welcome with us, worshiping with us today on site, and those of you online, whether it's today or some point during the week. We hope and pray this is a time of blessing for you in your week. If you're a guest today, there are connection cards there with the hymnals. We invite you to fill one out and drop it in the offering plate. We'd love to connect with you and share a little bit more, maybe be a part of your spiritual journey. Lots of things happening. There are announcements in the bulletin. Want to highlight just a couple. The flu clinic this Wednesday from 4 to 6 downstairs in Ritchie Hall. Come, bring your insurance card and get that shot so you stay healthy as you can. We'll have evening prayer on the 18th in the chapel at 6:15 between the two sessions of discipleship classes on Wednesday night. So come and be a part of that. Senior Academy, details are in the bulletin. That begins this Tuesday. So be sure and check the bulletin, watch Faith Life for additional announcements and details, and I want to introduce Mark Lewis, who has our stewardship moment for us this morning. Thank you, Mark.
Consecration Sunday is based on the biblical philosophy of the need of the giver to give for his or her own spiritual development rather than on the need of the church to receive. Instead of treating people like members of a social club who pay dues, we will treat people like followers of Jesus Christ who want to give unselfishly as an act of discipleship. Consecration Sunday encourages people toward proportionate and systematic giving in response to the question, what percentage of my income is God calling me to give? To consecrate means dedicated to a sacred purpose. Next Sunday, you will be asked to prayerfully discern your response to God's mission here at St. John's and then bring your pledge cards forward at the end of the service. This is an act of worship where you are showing a response to God's call in your life. Collectively, we have the ability to supercharge our mission here. On page 3 of your bulletin, if you'll take a minute to look at it, You will find a stair-step diagram of our congregation's pledges for 2022. There are 440 family units that have the potential to pledge. Let's start with looking at the lowest step, where we see that of the 440 family units, that 218 do not currently pledge. Now, I can tell you there are family units that don't pledge but do give regularly and faithfully, and for that we are very thankful. Still, there are many that have not begun a regular, faithful pattern of financial stewardship. Could this be the year that you begin? My daughter, Rebecca, wave, graduated from Western Carolina University in May and just accepted a position at DSS. Guess who's going to be jumping on the bottom step for the first time? It may only be the first step, but it starts the discipline of sacrificial giving, responding to God's call. Next Sunday is Consecration Sunday, and Pastor Danielle Denise will be preaching at both services. The day begins with a brunch in Ritchie Hall that will remain open from 9 to 11:30 for your enjoyment. We ask that everyone please RSVP for the brunch, even if you plan to attend a service and not eat. You can do so easily on the church website or by calling the church office or by responding to my email or call tomorrow. God's blessings are free-flowing and without limit. In our loving response to these blessings, we offer our pledge in support of his ministry plan. This year, God is calling my family to take one step up. What is his calling for you? Is it to take that step up to the next giving level or to begin pledging for the very first time? Either way, I pray that you will seek his call in your life and respond to his blessings, both lovingly and joyfully. He will, in turn, take these gifts and magnify them in ways we have yet to see.
A reading from the book of Exodus. Then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third and the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your town. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. When all the people witnessed the thunder and lightning, the sound of the trumpet, and the mountain smoking, they were afraid and trembled and stood at a distance and said to Moses, "You speak to us and we will listen, but do not let God speak to us or we will die." Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid, for God has come only to test you and to put the fear of him upon you so that you do not sin." Then the people stood at a distance while Moses drew near to the thick darkness where God was. Word of God, word of life, thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 21st chapter. Jesus said to the people, "Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, 'They will respect my son.' But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, 'This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance.' So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants?" They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the harvest time." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes.' Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken into pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they realized he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowd because they regarded him as a prophet. This is the gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for your word, for your law, which leads us back to you, which shows us the way to life. Let now the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I'm going to start this morning with a confession. Siblings in faith, I am a really, really, really terrible dancer. Not what you expected. The Lord has blessed me with many gifts, I think. Rhythm and grace are not among them. Much of my time spent at the social functions of my youth was devoted with a manic-like fervor to trying to avoid the dance floor. It's not that I don't like to dance. You should see me when I'm by myself, jamming to my music. I'm just really bad at it. You must imagine my anxiety then, when one of the first things I learned about my fiancée, Nicole, was that she was a dancer. In college, she even dabbled a little bit in choreography. How long until she found me out? Didn't take long. You must also imagine my anxiety then, being young in youth ministry, as the trend of TikTok dances arose in youth culture. Yes, I'm looking at you, acolytes. Nope. No, thank you. I do not want to feature in your dance TikToks. When the kids pull out their phones to record at our gatherings, I make like that one meme of Homer Simpson, maybe you've seen it on the internet, where he like slowly disappears into the hedges. Now, all silliness aside here, I'm bringing up my gracelessness and the trend of these TikTok dances to get to this point. We are all being influenced, taught, discipled by something. Everything that we consume as media, whether that's film or TV or music or social media or whatever, everything we try to imitate or emulate, these things come in ways that are both big and small to shape our imaginations, to form our hearts, whether we want to acknowledge it or not. A few examples. We'll stick with TikTok for the first one. The music that plays in the background of those TikTok dances often contains lyrics which I know our children and our families don't endorse. Now, I'm not trying to rain on anyone's parade, but that can begin to seep into our imaginations, can it? Change the way we speak and act to one another. Or let's take film and TV for another example. Conceptions of beauty and attractiveness, or even the ways that relationships are portrayed, can begin to shape our vision. We can begin to look at one another and ourselves in ways that are, maybe at best, uncharitable, and at worst, exploitative. You see, what we consume matters. What we watch and listen to, the things we invest our precious leisure time into, all of those things, whether we want to admit it or not, have the potential to come right back and to form who we are. This formation has consequences, as we know, at a micro level for our own lives, but also at a larger picture macro level for our world. If we were to look at the top streamed music, the most watched movies, the most played video games, it's no wonder that our world continues to feel more and more unsettled, broken, and divided. This is why I think right after giving the first commandment of the Ten Commandments, God reminds the people of the generational impact of following them. Blessing and curses for generations to come, right? Because who we follow shapes us, and by extension, it shapes our world. Who we are discipled by has generational implications. Think about the cycles of brokenness that we see repeated time and time again in our world. Now, the background of this passage of Exodus is that Moses has just led the Israelite people out of 400 years of slavery and oppression in Egypt, and into freedom, heading towards God's promise of milk and honey. But before they get there, they must make a pit stop at Mount Sinai in the middle of the wilderness, where they go up the mountain to receive the Ten Commandments. These ten are the heart of the Jewish Torah, the first five books of the Bible. Torah is a word that means law, or even better, instruction. Now, that said, these commandments, as we probably know and have experienced, can get twisted really quickly into a checklist of personal righteousness and morality. It's a shame because they're meant to be so much more than that. The main thrust of this text and these commandments suggest that this isn't necessarily designed, first and foremost, to be punitive. Instead, these commandments are best considered as gifts because God knows what we humans need. We need instruction. We need a path to follow. We need markers to help us along our way. First and foremost, without a conversion of the heart, without a shift in our mindset and imaginations, the patterns and the practices that those people learned for 400 years in Egypt could easily become the dominant model for them going forward. With that in mind, at its core, most of the Jewish law in the Old Testament can be read as a text of resistance. You see, they're not necessarily or primarily about punishment or reward, though those inevitably follow, and that fear does help us to take them seriously. Instead, it's really about setting up a just and a compassionate society, one that resists the dominant imagination, the dominant practices of the time. Again, God knows what the people need, and more than anything else, it's that change of heart, it's that shift in imagination. The Ten Commandments are intended to function as guide rails, as boundaries to the good life, a life of deep and rich relationship with God and with one another. The Torah itself is meant to disciple the people, as the Jewish tradition has demonstrated faithfully and insightfully throughout the ages. There's some good stuff to dig into there. Now, all this begs a question, which I want to ask you directly. Who or what is discipling you? Who are you trusting as your teachers? This may seem counterintuitive at first, but I want to suggest that for the majority of us, we spend much more of our time being discipled by the media of our day than by the God that we encounter in Scripture and through our worship. Many people adhere more closely to their political party nowadays or listen more to their favorite news anchor or outlet than they do to Jesus. Most young people spend most of their time playing online video games or scrolling through social media than they do with their in-person relationships or teachers. Philosopher and social critic Charles Taylor notes that in the last century there has been this nova effect in our culture. There's been a supernova explosion of options for us to invest our time into. There's more and more content and media to be consumed than ever before. And so among all these options, we, maybe more now than ever, need to be continually asking ourselves, who's teaching us? What is it that we are learning? How is it changing us? What direction are we headed? You see, the trick with the Old Testament law, and even with the instructions of the New Testament, is that it is subject, as we know, to interpretation. It's easy to twist Scripture to our own ends and understandings, more often than not, misunderstandings. And reading literally, I hate to say it, more often than not, is a myth. This is especially true of texts like the books of the Bible because they come from different languages and different cultures and different time periods. And so when we approach them with our contemporary ways of reading, with our contemporary ways of thinking, we all do a bit of translation and interpretation on our own. And as you probably know, one of the things we love nowadays are rules. And it's easy to follow the letter of the law, to dot all its I's, to cross all its T's, and to miss the spirit, its true meaning, entirely. In our gospel reading this morning from Matthew 21, that's paired with the Ten Commandments, this very thing happens. Jesus shares a parable about a landowner who planted a vineyard and hired these tenant workers to keep it. And when the harvest time came, these tenants murdered the landowner's servants and even his son, trying to claim the harvest and the reward for themselves. Now, when the religious authorities of the day heard this parable and the others, they began to sweat because they knew that it was about them and their mistreatment of the law. You see, they had excelled at following all of the rules. They were righteous, but they had missed entirely the spirit of why those rules were established in the first place. They used the rules to elevate only themselves instead of using them to restore and uplift the community. With this, we come back to our core value of the day, discipleship. The word disciple simply means student or learner. Christian disciples are students of Christ, those who study and practice the way of Jesus. For Martin Luther, this meant that we first must approach Scripture with cross-shaped lenses. You see, discipleship 101 is first learning how to read properly. We must first read Scripture with Jesus in mind, Old Testament and New. We then must practice what Luther called a theology of the cross, living our lives not for our own glory, but after instead the way of Christ, especially that sacrificial love of God that we find on the cross. We've got to constantly remember to let the life and the teachings and the cross and the resurrection of Jesus influence our relationships. We must always challenge ourselves to let Jesus be our primary teacher. This is why we take discipleship seriously at St. John's. We're discipled first and foremost here in our worship, where we're filled up and reminded of God's love. We're empowered and sent out to serve. But we also strive to study the way of Christ through our many, many offerings of classes and book and Bible studies, especially in our children and youth programming. If you haven't taken a moment to consider all of the ways we do that throughout the week, I want to encourage you to do so. We've got our tried and true Martin Luther Sunday School class still meeting. We've got a new class being started and led by Mark Ritchie on spiritual disciplines. It meets in the well between the services. We've got men's and women's Bible studies that meet throughout the week. We've got offerings on Wednesday night after our community meals. The life of discipleship is more than just about being in the right place and the right time on Sunday mornings. That certainly starts there. What we consume, I'll say it again, matters. Who we let into our hearts and teach us can lead and shape our lives. And we can't get enough of Jesus throughout our week, I'll promise you that. I want to close by talking about a really provocative treatise that Martin Luther wrote in 1525 called How Christians Should Regard Moses. In that document, he describes the Ten Commandments as a mirror of our lives. Earlier in that same document, he wrote and reminded Christians that we no longer have to follow the rules. Christ's cross and resurrection have justified us, have already worked out our salvation. That is past tense. We no longer have to earn it. All we have to do is to place our faith, our trust, in Jesus. And thanks be to God, there's always grace and forgiveness for when we fail. This is the good news of the gospel in a nutshell. But the commandments still function as a mirror in at least two different senses. First, they expose us. They show us who we really are and where our loyalties lie. Maybe most importantly, they show us that we can't do it alone. That we need God's grace. The second sense is that in doing so, they show us our potential, how we can grow to be more like Christ. The commandments are mirrors that reveal our flaws, yes, but again, they testify to that potential. And they always point us back to Jesus. If we use them to keep people down, to make ourselves feel better, then we have missed the point. We're trying to justify ourselves, doing something that Christ has already done for us instead of letting God be God and placing our faith in Jesus. I'll say it again one last time. Who we are allowing to disciple us, it matters. Everything we consume or encounter has a chance to influence us. Now make no mistake here, I'm not telling you to put down your favorite TV show or movie. I'm not telling you to turn down the volume on your favorite musical artist. That's not what I'm doing. I think we can find God present in all sorts of places, maybe in some we don't even expect. But what we do have to do is be continually mindful of who or what at the end of our day is that primary influence. Where is our foundation underneath it all? Where is that filter that helps us read, that helps us consume properly? With that in mind, I want to leave you with maybe my favorite thing about the Ten Commandments, something that's easily forgotten or overlooked. We humans love rules. We want to jump into the list. This comes just as God is beginning to speak to Moses. He reminds him, "I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me." Commandment 1. Here God reminds the people of his identity before he even gives them the first commandment. You see, the good news of the gospel is that the God we worship is always the God of freedom and liberation. Our God is the one who liberates captives, who comes to redeem us, to transform our hearts, to heal our world time and time again. This is really what the commandments are all about. We shouldn't use them to build up more walls or fences. We use them to join in that work of liberation. This is what the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus is all about. This too is what the life of discipleship is all about. Growing in our faith so that we can join in that rhythm of freedom and in that pattern of healing the world. Amen.
Thank you.
Gathered as God's people across time and space, we join our voices confessing our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We make peace with our brothers and sisters in Christ and share a greeting as appropriate. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
His heart, his heart, the
Let us pray. God of power, God of plenty, all things belong to you. We bring your gifts to the table that all might be fed. Form us into the body of your beloved, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Our prayers continue as we trust in the transformative power of God's loving Spirit, praying for the church, the world, and all in need. God of all grace, give us ears and a heart to look and to listen for your word, your guidance, to gather with others who build us up, who inspire us in faith, ones with wisdom and insight that we might more and more be your faithful disciples in the places you send us, in the ways that you gift us and call us to be, for the sake of the community, for the sake of the world. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of all grace, you are the source of life and joy. Strengthen the resolve of your church throughout the world. We pray for Bishop Eaton, for Bishop Smith, pastors and lay leaders everywhere, that together we may press forward together toward the goal of your heavenly call in Jesus Christ. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of all creation, you plant and nourish the earth as your own precious vineyard. Bless the fields and orchards that they might bring forth bounteous harvest. Bless and strengthen the hands of those who labor in the fields gathering the harvest so that your people everywhere might be fed. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of all the earth, you desire peace and justice between nations and peoples. We pray especially for our brothers and sisters in Israel and Palestine and the outbreak of war and violence there. Break in with your presence. Bring healing, bring hope, bring new possibilities that end that divide. Guide leaders, guide our elected leaders in our own nation, states, and cities, that they may faithfully govern your people with wisdom, integrity, and compassion. God of all grace, hear our prayer. God of compassion, in Christ you lovingly poured yourself out like wine for all people. Have mercy on all who mourn. We pray especially for families and friends of Martha Blackburn, Barry Rogers, and others whom we name before you now. Hold in your care and be gracious to all who struggle with mental health, with homelessness, and other issues of life. Hear the cries of those who cry out for justice and peace. We pray especially for those in Afghanistan following the devastation of the earthquake there. Bring hope, bring restoration. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of all steadfastness, you set Christ as the cornerstone and foundation of the church. Build up St. John's as living stones that we might stand in the community as a faithful witness to your enduring faithfulness and love. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of all hope, the saints who came before us lived and died with their hearts fixed on you. We give you thanks for their faithful witness, and we wait with hope for the great day when we join their voices in praise of you. God of grace, hear our prayer. Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace. God is at work in you. Thanks be to God.